One of the biggest art shows of the year is starting in 2 days' time. Tate Modern will be opening its doors to Damien Hirst's first British retrospective. And I'm going to be taken on a guided tour by the man himself. And to be honest, I'm a bit scared.
He's the biggest artist in the world, and he deals with death. He once took a chainsaw and cut a cow in half. He put sharks in galleries. I don't really know what to expect. Is he a clown? Is he a showman? Is he a genius? Maybe he's the devil.
There's only one way to find out. Damien Hirst changed what art looks like, what it means, and what it's worth. And by the time I got to art school in the 90s, he turned art into the new rock and roll. He's arguably Britain's most famous living artist. And he's made Britain famous for making art. He's the biggest, the richest, the baddest, and the boldest. And this is a chance to look back at his whole career and see what all the fuss is about. This is a show that's been 4 years in the planning. And to install it, the work hasn't just been shipped in ready-made. It's been put together on site. Cows have been dropped into formaldehyde, cabinets filled with endless pills, hundreds of spots painted, thousands of butterflies and flies specially bred, and a shark has been shipped in from the other side of the world. This isn't like nailing a few pictures to the wall. It takes 6 technicians, 6 days to put all 23 tons of this work together. It's the piece that everyone remembers him for, and when I first saw it, it changed what I expected to see in an art gallery forever. Showing me around the shark, Damien seemed quite nice, not as scary as I thought he'd be.
It's incredible, this.
Da-da. Da-da. Are you scared of sharks as well?
I'm sort of obsessed with them as well. But yeah, a bit. He's got a different face, this one.
Well, now you open the mouth, because I always wanted to open the mouth, but it's like, you keep, when you first preserve him, you can have him in whatever position you want. And with the other one, it had the mouth closed.
It's pretty.
Same face as you close the mouth. Look, it's, I mean, it's a shark's got all mouth, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
You're all mouth.
That is incredible, though. Like a spaceship. It's just coming.
Be big enough, isn't it? When you get close, you just can almost be in there with it.
Yeah, and you think, oh, wow.
It's pretty scary.
You think, oh, I wouldn't have a chance.
This shark's distant cousin was first shown 20 years ago in the Saatchi Gallery, but not everyone was a fan.
What you got is a shark, a big fish, in a tank of formaldehyde. How does it become a work of art? It isn't good enough for Damien to say it's in a gallery, therefore it's a work of art.
It's an amazing thing to do, to take a shark and put it into an artistic environment. Do you know what I mean? Whether it's a discussion or whether it's an art gallery, it doesn't really matter. Because anyone can go to a natural history museum and, you know, and probably see a shark. But you won't consider it unless you've been asked to consider it in a different way, which is what he does.
Getting hold of a shark wasn't that easy. Driven by his mad idea, Damien started phoning up post offices in Australia and getting them to stick wanted posters around town. Eventually, his call was answered by legendary Australian shark hunter Vic Hislop.
As big as anybody's ever caught this shark, it's a monster.
It's more like a whale. Not allowed his first choice, an endangered great white, Damien had Vic ship a 12-foot tiger shark. Once it was pickled, the British tabloids took the bait.
The Sun had this sort of furious diatribe, fish without chips, somebody pays £50,000, you know, and it sort of started the whole furore about young British art, which I thought was wonderful. He made it necessary for newspapers to take an interest in art.
But just as striking as the shark itself is Damien's title for it. the physical impossibility of death in the mind of someone living.
I was just trying to describe that fact that, you know, death doesn't exist. You can't. If you're alive, it's like the antithesis of death, isn't it? So you just can't believe it. So we used to have a skull at my school that we used to draw. I used to get it and look at it and go, that used to be a living guy, and it just didn't happen in my head. Just go, that used to be a guy or a woman, and you go, nah, and it just, you can't activate it. I cannot believe that that was like somebody talking around about it.
I mean, that...
It's a good way, though, to focus your fear, isn't it? It's a fear of sharks instead of a fear of death.
Do you think you substituted a shark with
death? Oh, yeah, totally.
Is that just a metaphor for death? Yeah. You facing it?
Yeah, but if somebody comes up to me and goes, is that a metaphor for death? I go, it's a shark, you klutz. And if they go, is that just a shark? I go, no, it's a metaphor for death. Never really put the meaning in there. They're just triggers that just hijack any meaning. So I've always gone...
Yeah.
So if anybody says, is that what it's about? I always go, yeah, definitely.
It means you put a squirrel in there, it's not going to have the same impact because people aren't scared of squirrels.
But that's the challenge, isn't it? You go, how do I create that same thing with a squirrel? It can be done.
Do you think?
Yeah, definitely.
With a squirrel?
You just go, Damien Hirst worked brilliant. I mean, I love the sheep. The shark terrified me, but oh, my God, the squirrel. Never thought a squirrel should be so terrifying.
Do you like it when kids like your stuff? Because it's more...
I love it, yeah.
It's more instinctive, isn't it?
I mean, if a little kid came and went, that's boring. I mean, like, Damien Hirst, it's boring. I'd be, like, devastated.
Yeah.
I used to get hate mail as well. I got hate mail really early on. I got people telling me I was the Mengele of the art world and...
Really? But not from children. They don't bother, do they?
Kids love it.
They've got no time either to write letters to people. Too busy enjoying life.
I said to Cyrus, my son who's six, would you rather have in your bed a zombie or a girl? And he went, zombie.
He's Oscar Wilde in so many ways, but his is the importance of not being earnest. You know what I mean? Serious, serious subjects with a silly grin on his face.
Something that's quite important with Damien is that he is always joking. There's always a stream of jokes, and they're usually filthy or quite dark.
He has a humour about him, like a naughty schoolboy. And that's what gets him through life, I think.
He used to talk to his gran. And he always would say things to her like, when you die, I'll put you in a piece of artwork. And he used to say things like that, and she used to laugh about it.
Damien Hirst isn't just known for preserving bodies and formaldehyde. He's made more spot paintings than anything else, 1,400 at the last count, and many of them are dotted around this exhibition. He only ever did about 20 himself before he handed the job over to his army of assistants.
These are ones I actually painted.
Oh, these are your own?
I think so, yeah. You can see the holes in the centres where the compass marks are, and they've got like a... They're all wobbly painted.
I think I like wonk. I like the wonk a little bit, which is why I like compass marks and things.
I don't know, we're all a bit... I mean, I think human beings try and make order out of the world, don't they? So you you've got to get rid of your wonk. But it comes out in other ways.
But you're making order out of colour here, aren't you?
I suppose, yeah. I mean, I like that.
Beautiful colours, though. I love colour. So you're obsessed with colour, aren't you?
Yeah, I love it.
I'm obsessed with colour. You said you prefer colour to people sometimes.
Definitely, yeah. I hate people.
It's a really good orange. It's much better than most of your mates. Dave, get out of the way. There's a really nice pink behind you. I know what you mean, though. I get obsessed with colour. And did you do this one?
Yeah.
I do like it.
No, I definitely didn't do all this one. There's too many spots on it for me to have not given up. I must have had assistance on that. I'd stopped doing spot paintings and then I did that one. I just went, if I did them 3 foot, they'd be just mental. It's like something totally different.
I think I prefer the bigger spots.
Good. They're hard to choose, aren't they? Mm. That's nice. Oh, that's nice. I gave my mum a painting, and one day I walked past it and I go, that needs to be purple. And I can't get it out of my head. And it just ruins it for me every time I go, it's wrong. And I got it off the wall, and I painted a brown one orange, and I did it really badly, and she sent it back to my studio and got to repaint it.
I was finding Damien charming and funny, and not like Dr. Death at all. Maybe he's going to reveal his evil side to me in part two.
Oh, man.
That stinks.
Whose idea was that?
Damien Hirst has spent his life being one step ahead of the rest of us. Now he's looking back with his first British retrospective, and we can follow his journey from Leeds to global art stardom. He's given me the first ever guided tour. And the journey begins here, a room made up of his earliest works.
This is it, this is the room. Where it all started.
Yeah, this is when the first room that you come in with all the. Somebody asked me the other day, what's the focus of the show? Right. I said it starts with embarrassment and ends with hope. This is embarrassment.
You're not really embarrassed by this, though, are you?
I'm embarrassed by that piece.
Really?
Yeah.
I quite like that. Is that wrong? The colours are there.
And yeah, but it's a bit car boot, so. Look at that.
I mean, that.
Should we just stay in this room? Are these your favourites? It's all
like
downhill
them.
From after this.
I mean, this is, you know, an early version of the spots, isn't it? But I love this. I thought it was much smaller than that. I've only seen it in pictures. I think it looks great.
Yeah, I've seen it here now. I prefer it to what it looked like back in the day. When I did that, I thought, you know, because I curated a show with all my friends working it, and I actually thought they were brilliant, and I was crap.
The show is called Freeze, and it was a group exhibition by students from Goldsmiths Art College, which Damien organised in 1988.
I remember him scraping up the tiles from the floor and painting the building and doing the electrics for the lighting. I think I was more impressed with that than his work, that he did some boxes in the rafter, and I did like them, but I was more impressed with all the work he'd put in and the fact that he'd brought it all together.
Damien was pretty much the spearhead for it all. You might go out for quite a heavy night, get home at 4 o'clock in the morning, and at 8 o'clock he'd be up in his underpants. 10 minutes later he's on the phone talking to Norman Rosenthal at the Royal Academy.
Damien wasn't an artist waiting to be discovered. In Freeze, he grabbed the art world by the lapels and demanded to be noticed.
And you just organised sort of the best exhibition of that year while you were at college.
I don't know. I mean, it's like, it became kind of mythical. It's like, I mean, I have people come up to
it's
me.
Like a Sex Pistols.
Everybody says they were there, and it's like, I was there day in, day out, no one came. It's like,
you were getting cabs for people, weren't you, literally? Yeah, I'll get you here myself, I'll carry you there.
Yeah, I was picking people up in the morning and getting them down. I mean, I knew you had to get people listening to you before you can change their minds. The few people I brought down were key people who talked about it, you know.
Yeah.
Matthew Collins filmed it. Yeah. So I got it on the TV, and I remember looking at it thinking, I made it.
So what does everyone at the school think?
Well, there's a bit of mixed feelings, I think. There's a lot of people who are kind of anti-Freeze, mm-hmm. and a lot of people who are for it.
Who are the ones who are anti-Freeze? What are they at?
I don't know. I think it's just, you know, any kind of success, people don't really like it, do they?
You broke that up, didn't you? Did you
I smashed it, yeah. But I, when I made
you
it at the time...
You sold it, didn't you?
I sold it so for you did 500 sell... quid. But then the guy who bought it said... dropped in at the end. On condition, you make it in one piece.
Yeah.
And then I tried to tape it all together, and I couldn't do it, so I smashed it up.
You should have just sent it in footage of you smashing it up.
Well, I could give him his 500 quid back.
He paid for it, didn't he?
Yeah, paid
never
for
gave
it.
Him back?
Never gave me it back.
That's brilliant.
Sprayed in yellow.
Yellow. And purple.
Also in this room is a photograph of Damien when he was 16, visiting an anatomy museum in Leeds.
You couldn't do that now, could you? How old were you there?
16, I think.
16.
Yeah.
I couldn't do that now. Maybe when you're 16, you're fearless, aren't you?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's like a
I mean, the whole thing was to prove to people I was in the anatomy museum.
Right.
Like, people just went, hey, you're talking, you're lying.
Yeah.
Like, no, honestly, I'm in there. And you get a head out, you
check
put it on the table.
Out.
And they weren't. And then I said,
right.
Out.
So you went there to draw them?
Yeah, well, that was one of the mad things, because it's like, you know, you're there to sort of draw, so you're like, you know, you're
so
looking
at
them. They're all like bodies that are, you know, sort of the nobody, whereas that's like just got such personality. I got that out of the fridge and I was like, what the hell is this?
Do you feel closer to this character now?
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Just a little bit. I used to feel like that, and then I was sort of in the middle, and now I'm just a bit closer to that.
I mean, it's weird when you see dead bodies, because they're not really... There's nothing in them. They're just sort of empty vessels, aren't they? You kind of...
Very hard to believe.
They're not sort of... They don't have the... I guess the soul's gone, but they don't have that...
Well, I've never really seen the dead body of someone that I've loved or been close to. Yeah, and I made it into an artwork, like, 10 years after it was done, because I sort of started doing that, getting some press saying I was Mr. Death or something.
Mr. Death? It's an anagram of your name, isn't it?
It is Death. Mr. Death in.
That's brilliant. I think Mr. Death is perfect, isn't it?
The Frieze exhibition was a huge success for artists like Matt Collishaw, Angus Fairhurst and Sarah Lucas, but not for Damien.
Whereas probably half of the artists went on to sell their work or get dealers and shows, Damien came out with it very little. He understood the fact that people really wanted something from contemporary art, and they wanted a larger-than-life statement of belief by the artist. So I think that gave him some resolve to make work that you could not possibly ignore.
And no one can ignore the first work he produced after Frieze.
It shocks me, this work.
Yeah, it shocks me. I can't.
But I don't know how I got from there to that.
Was it like instinctive?
I don't know, it's just sort of learning the language, aren't you? And you just suddenly get to a point where you manage to say something with it.
This is a huge leap, isn't it? It's like...
Yeah, should have given up after that.
Well, I mean, it doesn't matter if people like this or don't like this, it's like being punched in the face.
It's got everything, including the smell.
The smell punches you in the face, the imagery punches you in the face.
The elements of a thousand years are simple. A box hatching maggots into flies, a rotting cow's head, an insect killer. Altogether, it's a gruesome life cycle.
I've kind of said that the fly killer works as an idea of some sort of god, but it's completely random. You go into the fly killer and die by chance.
I remember the first fly getting killed and just going, oh, God.
Oh, please, no.
Not another.
What have you done? Yeah. Frankenstein moment.
Yeah, Frankenstein moment, yeah. Every vegetarian restaurant is a fly killer for health and safety reasons, you know.
Yeah.
But when you kill a fly for art, it's like, what are you playing at? And then there's loads of references to loads of artists I liked at the time, like Bruce Nauman for the Neons, and Naum Garbo did these spatial things, and then Bacon, obviously, in the Cow's Head. Sol de Witt, like the Cube.
Wow.
And Bacon, Richard Serra.
Bacon loved this, didn't he? He saw it, he liked it.
Yeah, they said that at the Saatchi Gallery when they showed it. They told me it looked like, and stood in front of it for a while.
One of the things I've noticed with critics, they always talk about this violence of my work. But I don't think that my work is violent at all. You've only got to think about life. Perhaps it's sheer naturalism.
Is he your hero?
Yeah, I suppose. Hey,
that's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, in retrospect, but I don't know. It's hard to imagine it, really.
I know it seems.
I sort of think he would have probably hated everything else I ever made.
A year after making A Thousand Years, Damien turned from flies to butterflies with an ambitious two-room installation which is recreated here for the first time. In one room, dead butterflies are fixed onto canvas. In the other, they're born.
Some butterflies that fly better in lower light, higher light, morning, afternoon. It just gives a complete range. So whether the exhibition is visited early in the morning or late in the afternoon, the range of butterflies is quite large. The table in the middle is used for our fruit bowls. The amusing thing with the bigger fruit feeders is that the banana or an orange that's been sat there for a couple of days is almost pure alcohol to these guys. Not just in here, but as it would naturally in the wild. And by the end of the day, some of the owl butterflies can barely fly. And it's not through anything else than they are just completely drunk.
Wow.
This is mental, yeah.
And this, when you first did this, you bred the butterflies, didn't you?
Yeah, in my bedroom. But all again, you know, just again, I bred butterflies because I didn't have the money. The guy said to me, you can buy pupae for like £2 each, or you can get butterflies, live butterflies, for like £5 each. So I was like, give him the pupae.
You love that, getting on the phone, don't you, finding out?
And I used to love that. You just phone up, I mean, you know, somebody would go, I just have the maddest idea possible, and then sort of egg myself on.
These ones are drunk, aren't they? Absolutely wrecked. Hangover.
He's just got hangovers.
It's you and Kate, look.
Oh my God. Look at him.
That's the Groucho, that, right there.
Butterflies are strange, aren't they? Because they give us hope because they look alive when they're dead. It's not like, you know, you don't. They're not rotting corpses.
I think.
That, see that one flapping there? That's the first flap it's ever had.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, has it just come out of the pupa?
Yeah.
Wow. So it just came out of there?
Yeah.
Is that the pupa?
Yeah, they are, like that.
Wow. If I was like 10 and my dad brought me here, I'd be absolutely buzzing in this room. I'd just be like, this is great. Who's thought of this?
Yeah, but they are. It's just a butterfly house, isn't it? But then you get people going into the Natural History Museum and going, wow, I love this, look at that dinosaur. And then they walk in an art gallery going, what is this? And I'm thinking, that's stupid.
I love the fact that there's a butterfly house in an art gallery. It would make sense to anyone under 12. Maybe I'm a big kid, because it also makes sense to me. When I was an art student, Damien Hirst was always doing stuff he shouldn't. Like turning cigarette butts into sculpture. Cigarettes also feature in one of his most surreal early works.
Another box.
Another box. Not a lot in it than this one.
I love it because it's like a little set. It's like a little comedy set. I feel like I want to be in there as a doctor and you come in and we just sketch.
Yeah, that was my. It's weird because I used to smoke and I just loved that. I was totally pro-smoking and now I'm not.
I guess it's a man at his desk smoking himself to death. Slowly, though. Much slower.
It's called The Acquired Inability to Escape, and the title came from this guy in Switzerland who'd explained another work by another artist, and he described it to me as this piece with rats in it by Bruce Nauman, and it's like a guy playing the drums, and he said it's called The Acquired Inability to Escape, and I went, oh, man, what a beauty title. I wish I'd thought of that.
Yeah.
Then I went and looked up the piece.
And he got it wrong.
It was called Learned Helplessness in Rats. And I was like, what? So I went, I'm having that title. Brilliant.
Wow, so he got it wrong.
And then I built the piece from the title first. I got the title first. Yeah, totally got it wrong.
Awesome.
And then the box was sort of something that I'd done the dimensions of. It's all based on the human body. So I said, so this, the height, I went, it's going to be, you've got to have a sheet of glass that when you're looking at it, it's all in your whole vision. So I went, well, that's a few people like maximum 6 foot, so it's 7 foot. You're a fag.
as well as cigarettes. Drugs that you could buy over the counter became an obsession in Damien's work.
It's a familiar sight, perhaps too familiar. For in Britain today, we take more than 12,000 million pills, tablets and capsules every year. We're just eating the stuff. Some of it, of course, can make the difference between life and death.
Made in 1992, this recreation of a high-tech pharmacy is a sort of temple to our belief in the power of legal drugs.
I love this room. Drugs.
If we had a white coat on and somebody ill walked in, they'd just think that we were just there to help them, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
You are Jesus.
So this... I mean, this is about death as well, putting off death. But we're frightened.
That's always optimistic, isn't it, even if it's about death?
Yeah. Well, we're frightened of death, but we're sort of frightened of life, frightened of everything.
The contents of these cabinets promise to block out the fear if we believe in them enough.
I'm quite surprised how it looks contemporary to today, because this is like, I don't know, was it 20 years old or something? And a lot of the packaging's from then, and it's like, I thought in 20 years it's going to look like that one looks from the, you know, like 100 years old.
And it didn't.
No, it doesn't. It's still, you know, they haven't changed the packaging much. And, you know, if you look over the supermarket, everything's changed, you know. Even Coca-Cola's, all the bottles have changed, ketchup, Heinz and all that stuff. Whereas the medicine, they've sort of got it right, and they're going, this is how you design stuff to make people think you can make
this
them better.
It.
Get any drug out of there, and you pull the thing out, and it goes side effects, and it's 2 pages long, and it's like...
Yeah. Worse
nausea,
than what you've got.
Sweating, diarrhoea, vomiting.
Eyes bleeding.
I definitely thought, why do people believe in medicine and they don't believe in art? I mean, people walk in an art gallery and go, I've got a monkey that could do that. My dad was doing stuff like that and he's worked down a coal mine.
Yeah.
He could. When you can do a drawing of me that looks like me, then you're an artist. That's weird, isn't it? It's like, what is...
Did your mum get you into art? Just take you to galleries?
Yeah, she had an
stuff.
Art teacher that she hated at school, so she left school when she was like 15. I think you could leave earlier.
Yeah.
Than 16 if you wanted to leave. But she loved art, but hated her art teacher.
Right.
So I think she definitely encouraged me because she felt that she shouldn't have got out of it.
You've got to have a good art teacher. It's the key, isn't it? Did you have a good art teacher?
I did. I had a funny one, yeah. But he was more into theatre. He tried to get me into the theatre called Mr. Wood.
Teaching Damien art A-level in Leeds in the early 80s, Dave Wood knew he wasn't dealing with your average schoolboy.
Occasionally, he could come up with some statements which now, in retrospect, I think, oh, that was deep. I said to Damien, what do you think? What's the meaning of life? And he said, to get to the other side. He was an individual, a non-conformist. I think this is why, from a results point of view, his final A-level results were not good.
Damien definitely wasn't worrying about his A-levels when he picked up a chainsaw to begin his next project.
It's trying to rot and we're not going to let it.
How long have you got before it starts to rot completely?
It won't rot. Be okay, we'll inject it today.
He was carving a cow and a calf in two and preserving the bodies in formaldehyde. No one had ever done anything like this before, and no one knew if it was going to work. But it did, and now it's getting reassembled on site at Tate Modern. The finished work, Mother and Child Divided, changed the way people looked at art.
Seeing your news in a gas mask and thinking, who's he?
On the news in a gas mask.
In a gas mask. When you did this, I'd never seen anything like. I was like, what's he doing? I'd just never seen anything like this in a gallery. I was like, wow. Do you think this is the most shocking thing you've ever done?
I don't think any of it's shocking, really. In the newspapers it seems shocking, but, you know.
This is like, you know, an act of violence. You cut a cow up, but then you make something. It's really beautiful.
The symmetry of it is weird, because it is so violent, but then it seems it's like calm violence.
When did you become obsessed with death, do you think? Start to show yourself?
I think it's both, isn't it? It's life and death. I mean, you know.
Yeah, it is. Were you born obsessed with death? Are you obsessed with death when you were... You're not when you were a kid,
No, because I didn't know about death till I was about seven, but as soon as I found out about it,
You just thought...
So it was mean.
Yeah.
But then, you know, you have to confront things that you can't avoid, and you can't avoid it, so...
Normal, is this you dealing with death, though, thinking, right, I've cut
No, because the more you try and deal with it, the further it escapes from you. Like we were saying about that, with me with that severed head, it's like you're looking at it, you go, oh, there's death, and then you go, nah, it's gone.
Hates
I was surprised
it.
When people started putting it in the houses, posh people.
Oh, I love something like that. I would have something like that in my house. I think it's really beautiful.
I love it as well. And also it lasts, you know, it lasts for 200 years like that. You leave that there and, you know, 200 years' time, that'll still be there.
When the work was first shown, people started talking about the death of painting.
I was painting at college and when I saw this, I was quite frightened by it because I just thought, can you do painting after someone's done this? I don't know if you can.
You have to be able to.
But this feels like much more real than what you could ever paint.
Yeah, but I mean, you've always got that. I mean, you can't. I mean, a painting's real, isn't it? I don't know. I mean,
yeah, it is. Yeah.
But so I think it goes through fashion. I think you want. You just need things you believe in.
You're going to walk through here?
Yeah, with you.
Do
you walk through together?
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's great, though.
That's where the food goes in there. And then they choose it. And then it goes down there. And then. That grub like that pumps the blood round and then gets it eaten in there and then comes out as poo here.
It's like a map.
Look at the spine, mental.
Wow. It's beautiful. It is beautiful.
That's look how little the brain is.
Can you remember doing this, actually cutting it in half?
Yeah. Horrible. The first one we did, we cut from the back, got to the head, and then I went off at an angle and I ended up having one thin head and one fat head, and I was like, oh, no!
Got to do it again.
We had to
get
do it
another
again.
Cow!
And we had to do it again.
You know,
I remember thinking for a while, maybe I can just put it in there like that and pretend that's what I want. You know, that's what, when you do the paintings and they're a bit messy and they go wrong and you go, well, I meant it to go wrong. I could have done, no, that's the point. Yeah, it's got one thin head and one fat head. That's
it's
all
got to go. It's got to taper into a point.
It was Mother and Child Divided that led to Damien Hirst's second nomination for the Turner Prize in 1995.
I know they were still debating this late this afternoon. And the winner is Damien Hirst. Yeah!
It's amazing what you can do with an E and A level art. A twisted imagination and a chainsaw.
Following in the footsteps of Andy Warhol, Damien Hirst went on to reinvent himself as a brand. In his factory, instead of Campbell soup cans, a steady stream of spot paintings. I like them, but not everyone does.
How many spot paintings do you need to convince people that there is some merit in the idea of a spot painting? You know, does it matter if the spots are as big as that or tiny? Does it matter? Is there anything proportionate in them? Is there anything other than the bloody spots?
This is a spot painting. It's 12 by 6, the size of a full-size snooker table. And this is the first 147 that I had, which was at the Crucible in 1997. And it was the fastest 147, which was 5 minutes, 20 seconds. I wasn't here when they delivered it, because I was away playing at the time, but then I got a phone call from my dad saying they've had to take the front door off. He said, you wouldn't believe the team of people that have turned up. He said there must have been 8 of them here. Yeah, I can remember every shot. I remember the first red, I remember this red, I remember knocking the black over there, and then I just think, wow, look at that, where the white is. And to be able to see it in that form, it's like when they talk about, like, oh, you see the shots, you're so natural, you don't think. I don't see myself as that person, but to see someone outside my field talk about it and come up with something like that, you just think, I must be doing something right.
The spot paintings have helped make Damien Hirst become the world's richest living artist.
I've seen his wealth grow. Like, that's something that I noticed as a kid. Like, you know, there'd be a rented cottage and then suddenly a big house in Devon, and then there was an extension and then the helipad. And then it's like, oh, something's happening.
But money's not a subject he's embarrassed about.
When did you start earning enough money so that you just went, it's abstract now, I don't know, I've got enough, I can't even see it in
I got confused between... I remember we used to call 100,000 a long one. I'd be going, it's a long one for that painting. And then it was suddenly a million was a long one. And it's like, that's like... More than a street for 900,000 where I grew up.
A Death Star.
Yeah, you can buy the Death Star for 900,000.
Darth Vader's house.
And at some point, it's like 100,000 went to a million. And you just... I mean, it just becomes totally mental.
In 2008, on the eve of a global financial meltdown, Damien Hirst staged the most audacious act in art market history.
Warm welcome to Sotheby's and this historic sale. Damien Hirst, beautiful inside my head forever.
He bypassed his dealers for a two-day auction of his work, a move no artist had dared try before.
Damien's auction at Sotheby's was, by a matter of hours, the most extraordinary stroke of luck. The auction took place, and then the banks collapsed.
Lot number one, Heaven Can Wait.
That was amazing. That was the most fantastic piece of fortuitous theatrical coincidence you could possibly have hoped for.
I was celebrating here at 120,000, 120,000, 150,000, now 180,000, 180,000, 200,000, 220,000, now at 220,000, 250,000.
This represents the auction you had.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people think that's like the... It was like some big artwork. I mean, I never really thought of it like that, but I suppose in retrospect it was.
For £850,000. Sold to you, sir. Thank you.
I definitely had nightmares. I was thinking,
lot
six.
Don't sell anything.
Any offers? A pound? Tumbleweeds.
£5,100,000. £5,200,000.
And I'm in the pub going, I'm playing snooker with Ronnie O'Sullivan going.
We were just in a snooker in King's Cross playing snooker. I think we got in there about 6:30, 7:30. And then we was in there till about 9:30, 10:30 while all the bids were coming in.
And I'll start the bidding here at £6,500,000.
First bid come through.
£7,000,000 here on my right.
Dan was like, what's going on?
A bid at £800,000.
Each bid that kept coming through was just like...
Sold to you.
And I'm just potting balls, just trying to take his mind off.
And selling for £2,000,003.
With the auction still going on, Damien joined other friends for tea.
It was surreal. I was up in his suite at Claridge's. He was doing something that every artist that's living wants to do, and that's make loads of money.
At £1,000,000, sir. At £1,000,000 with a leader.
Damien's watching on the computer, and his team are there, and he's having a cup of tea playing with his kids. Any advance on £68 million?
At £2,350,000.
Or so. Oh, yeah. You know, it's kind of... Can I have another cup of coffee, Damien?
£4,600,000. At £8,500,000. At £9,200,000. Sold! Congratulations.
Oh, yeah, help yourself. Have a bit of cake as well, if you want.
The sale raised £111 million, a record for a living artist.
When I was a kid, the most money you ever saw was if you won on a fruit machine, you know, when it all just kept coming out.
Isn't that brilliant?
Oh, my God! And you were, like, 12 or 10 or something. And then you'd be like, wow! It never got any better than that, cos that was like treasure. That was, like, out of a chest.
That's what it was like for me on the auction.
Was it? Just coming out.
Yeah.
Brilliant noises.
You have to respect it. I've had to learn to respect it. I mean, I was afraid of it in the beginning. You know, if you don't have money. But I remember saying I don't care about money, and then And then the numbers get big, I'm like, yeah, give me what you think. Then, you know, if you know, somebody goes, well, what's, how much is that shark worth? You go, well, if two guys who've got a lot of money both want it, it's worth a lot.
Yeah.
But if no one likes it, I want, you know, it's all about desire as well.
But everyone says that, I don't care about money, but then if you go, can I have all your money? They're not going to suddenly go, yeah, it's all in there.
Yeah, I don't care.
Making money out of art is one thing, but Damien is one of the few artists to turn money into art. His diamond skull, For the Love of God, is one of the most expensive works ever to be shown at Tate Modern. Housed in a specially built vault, it will be guarded by a team of security staff, with visitors only able to see it in small groups. Encrusted with 8,601 flawless diamonds, it reportedly cost him £14 million to make. But by the time it was completed, the asking price was already £50
million. The skull, you know, with the diamonds on it, is that a way of dealing with money, by making the most expensive art?
Yeah,
ever?
I remember when I made that, I remember thinking, you know, when you're an artist, you make art from what's around you. And, yeah. You know, and I had a lot of money, you know. And it's magic.
And is the skull about immortality as well?
Of course it's about immortality. I mean, all art is about immortality.
That's going to last forever, isn't it?
But not all of Damien's diamonds are real. Judgment Day is a cabinet full of cubic zirconia. But it still doesn't come cheap.
If you bought your girlfriend that, she would love you.
How much is it?
A lot of money, $10 million.
Discount?
50% to you.
She'd be gone if
you
I
can
gave
have it.
That.
Can tell me what you think. I'm not into money. You can have it.
You don't care about money, do you?
I don't care about money at all.
I'll have all yours.
Last stop on my tour with Damien is a room with an angel, surrounded by butterflies, framed like the stained glass windows of a cathedral.
Wow. So this room, to me, this is like heaven. Look at this.
Well, that's mental.
Unbelievable.
But Jesus makes them, doesn't he?
He does, doesn't he?
It's not art, Jesus makes them.
This is all religious imagery, but you don't believe in God, do you? Or do
well,
you?
Well, no, definitely not. But I think that the church was very clever, wasn't it? Because it just used everything available
you like
to
the
make
imagery.
You believe. I mean, the imagery is brilliant, you know. I mean, they built cathedrals, you know, that whole form, these shapes are all from cathedrals. And it's like, you just go, look, let's build a house bigger than everybody else and get them in here and tell them God lives here. And you just go.
It's God's
and then,
house.
And then at the end, yeah, it's God's. And
what
then,
would God's house be like? It'd be big, wouldn't it?
Bigger than yours, yeah.
Nice windows.
You couldn't do that in a little mud hut.
Coloured windows, big
yeah,
house.
Bright coloured windows, everything available at the time, isn't it? It's like, you know, art, colour, sculpture, the greatest artists of the time. You just get them all in there and say, this is God's house.
God's
Who's not going to believe that?
Where is he, though? He's out.
Above.
Above. But what if you got it wrong?
No, I don't. Do you believe in God?
No. If there's a tiny doubt, then you do, don't you?
Yeah, I mean, I don't. I mean, I don't know.
You
I can't
don't.
Find a way around it. I mean, you know, my confusing thing is that I believe in art. My belief in art is religious. It's like, I just think it gives you salvation.
So you're spiritual, but you just don't believe
in it. Well, I mean, yeah, but I do it every day. You know, I'm always going, wow, I'm being blown away that, you know, you take two things that are meaningless, you put together and it creates meaning. And it's like,
it creates meaning and beauty.
But amazing beauty. You know, you go, that's kind of boring on its own, but if you put it next to that, it isn't boring, it's mind blowing. And you go, well, how does that happen?
When you go around your whole exhibition like that and you just think, that's 25 years of your life, isn't it?
I think it's the babbling of an insane mind. You just think, can't you focus? Can't you just focus and make some proper art? I've been into the now for so long, it's quite difficult to look at the then, you know. You just go, it's a long time ago.
When you see all of this together, it's quite overwhelming because it's so much work and, you know,
it's
so many great things.
It all feels new except that first room. I always tried to say, you know, love it or hate it, it doesn't matter as long as you can't get it out of your head or something like that.
Hip you're blue and you don't know where to go to, why don't you go where Harlem sits, putting on the red.
When you see it all together like this, does it make it clear for you where you're going to go next? Do you see it all?
God, no, that'd be a nightmare. I don't even know where you're going next. I've never known that. I'm not into that at all. You know, you just got to keep going. I mean, you know, try not to stand still.
Before I met Damien Hirst, I didn't know if he was a genius, a showman, or a devil. Now I know he's all of those things and much, much more. He's the naughty child who makes us confront our deepest fears, a surrealist businessman. He's the Grim Reaper in clown shoes. If you want to sneak a peek at this show before the doors even open, join me for your very own interactive private view. Go to channel4.com/Hirst now.
Artists, look how many there are. Millions of them. Artists, alphabetical. A.
You've got to be all right with that, haven't you?
No, only in a little section. And under H.
Who else is an H? Hockney.
Hockney, Hirst.
I've got butterfly eggs in my hair.
So, like Noel said, for your own private view of Damien Hirst's exhibition before the doors even open, go to channel4.com/Hirst. And there's more from Damien Hirst tonight on For His Thoughts, Work, Life at 12:15, if you're about. Next, know all the bits and bobs about your bits and bobs. Embarrassing bodies.